Recorded Books presents Relentless by Jack Campbell, narrated by Christian Rummel.
This is John G. Henry, who writes the Lost Fleet series under the pen name Jack Campbell, as well as the Stark's War series and the Jagged Space series. Since this is the introduction to the fifth book in this series, I'm going to answer some questions which have come up fairly often regarding writing the books. Like many people, I spent many years thinking that someday I should try writing something. When I retired from the Navy, it seemed as good a time as any to try that seriously. Writing is not an easy field to break into. You have to be prepared to get a lot of rejection slips, most of which will be in the form of rejection letters that provide absolutely no idea why your story has been rejected. One of the most important things an author has to do is to keep writing despite all of those rejections, because writing is like so many other things in that the more you do it, the better you get at it. You don't want to keep rewriting the same story over and over, though. Doing different stories, trying different things, and drawing on past experiences in work and life all help writing ability improve. I'm one of those writers who can do short fiction as well as novels, and I usually tell people I started writing the short fiction so I would have something to do while waiting for my novels to be rejected by agents and publishers. But short fiction also taught me important lessons in telling a story without either wasting words or leaving out essential parts of the story. Back in the 1960s and 1970s, any work over 40,000 words was considered a novel. By the time I signed my first book contract in the mid-1990s, it required a book length of 60,000 words. My current contracts call for 90,000 words. That's now pretty much the standard length expected for science fiction novels, and fantasy novels are expected to be even longer. The publishers demand certain lengths of novels, so the writer has to produce a good story that fits within the length the publisher insists upon. That requires pacing out the story and making sure you have enough story to fill that length. I tend to write novels using a rough outline of what will happen and then bouncing back and forth through the story, writing sections as they come to me. That helps avoid getting stuck when I can't work out a way through a scene because I can move to another scene and work on that one. I sometimes get asked how many drafts I go through on a novel, but there's no real way to answer that because I don't write out the entire book and then go back to make changes. Instead, I'm constantly reviewing and reworking scenes, moving things around, and then tying the pieces together. Agents and editors can ask for changes in a manuscript, and one of the things a writer sweats is wondering how many changes will be demanded of them. During my career in the Navy, I wrote a lot of messages and other documents, and got used to sending them up to chain of command and then getting them back covered with changes. A 2-page message might easily have more changes than there had originally been text, and there were always what we called happy-to-glad changes, used to describe cases where you had used a word like happy and some superior officer had changed the word to glad just so they could have some impact on the final product. You can imagine my worries when I first submitted a book-length manuscript for review. You can also imagine my shock when the manuscript came back with fewer changes than a typical 2-page message would have endured from the chain of command in the military. For better or worse, my agent and my editor are usually happy with what I give them, usually asking for only minor changes. Now I hope you enjoy The Lost Fleet, Relentless.
Chapter 1. The structure of the Alliance heavy cruiser Merlin shuddered again and again as hell lances fired by Syndicate Worlds warships ripped into and through her. Commander John Geary grabbed for support as a volley of Syndic grapeshot struck Merlin's port side, the impacts of the solid metal balls vaporizing part of the hull. Wiping a hand across his eyes to clear away sweat, Geary blinked through the fumes the overloaded and failing life support systems couldn't clear out of the atmosphere left inside the ship. His first real combat action might also turn out to be his last. Merlin tumbled helplessly through space, unable to control her motion, and the final hell lance still working on the Alliance warship went silent as more enemy fire ripped into her. There wasn't anything else he could do. It was time to go. Geary cursed as he got the emergency destruct panel open and punched in the authorization code. Another volley of hell lances sliced into Merlin, and more indicator lights on the bridge went out or shifted to blinking damage status. Geary pulled on his survival suit helmet, knowing that he had only 10 minutes before the power core overloaded and Merlin exploded. But Geary paused before he left the bridge. He'd ordered the remaining members of the crew off once it was clear that he alone could handle the few operational weapons and the final act of self-destruction. He bought all the time he could for his crew to get clear. But Merlin had been his ship, and he hated to leave her to her death. Another rumble, and Merlin's out-of-control tumble rolled sideways and up as more Syndic grape shots slammed into her, the passageways around Geary rotating dizzyingly, bulkheads thrusting suddenly toward him, then away, sometimes slamming painfully into him. His search became more desperate as he kept passing escape pod berths either empty or with mangled remnants of their rescue craft still wedged in place. He finally found one with a yellow status light, indicating damage, but he had no choice. Inside, seal the hatch, strap in, slap the eject control, feel the force of the acceleration pin him to the seat as the escape pod tore away from Merlin's death throes. The pod's propulsion cut off, much earlier than it should have. No communications, no maneuvering controls, environmental systems degraded. Geary's seat reclined automatically as the pod prepared to put him into survival sleep, a frozen state where his body could rest safely until his escape pod was recovered. As Geary's consciousness faded, his eyes on the blinking damage lights of the escape pod as they winked out into dormant status, he knew that someone would come looking for him. The Alliance fleet would repel the Syndic surprise attacks, reestablish control of the space around the star Grendel, and search for survivors from Merlin. He'd be picked up in no time. He opened his eyes on a blur of lights and shapes, his body feeling as if it were filled with ice, and his thoughts coming slowly and with difficulty. People were talking. He tried to make out the words as the blurry shapes began to resolve themselves into men and women in uniform. One man with a big, confident voice was speaking.
"It's really him? You've confirmed it?"
"DNA match with fleet records is perfect," another voice said. "This is Captain Geary. He's been badly physically stressed by the duration of his survival sleep. It's a miracle he came through this well. It's a miracle he came through at all."
"Of course it was a miracle,"
the big voice boomed. A face leaned close, and Geary blinked to focus, making out a uniform that was the color of the Alliance fleet, but otherwise different in details. The man beaming at him bore the stars of an admiral, but Geary didn't recognize him.
"Captain Geary?" Commander Geary,
he finally managed to reply.
"Captain Geary,"
the admiral insisted.
"You were promoted."
Promoted? Why? How long had he been out? Where was he?
"What ship?"
Geary gasped, looking around. From the size of the sick bay, this ship was much larger than Merlin. The admiral smiled.
"You're aboard the battlecruiser Dauntless, flagship of the Alliance fleet."
Nothing made sense. There wasn't any battlecruiser in the Alliance fleet named Dauntless.
"Crew. My crew?"
Geary managed to say. The admiral frowned and stepped back, motioning forward a woman who wore captain's insignia. Geary's gaze left the woman's face, unsettled by her expression of awe and distracted by the number of combat action ribbons on the left breast of her uniform. Dozens of them, but that was ridiculous. Topping her rows of ribbons was the one for the Alliance Fleet Cross. He couldn't even remember the last time one of those had been awarded.
"I'm Captain Dijani," the woman said, "commanding officer of Dauntless. I regret to inform you that the last surviving member of the crew of your heavy cruiser died about 45 years ago.
Geary stared. 45 years?
How long?
"Captain Geary, you were in survival sleep for 99 years, 11 months, and 23 days. Only the fact that the pod had a single occupant enabled it to keep you alive so long."
She made a spiritual gesture he recognized.
"By the grace of our ancestors and the mercy of the living stars, you lived and you have returned."
100 years? A wave of shock rode through Geary's slow-moving thoughts as he tried to absorb the news. not even trying to grasp why the woman had apparently seen some religious significance in his survival. The bad news having been delivered by someone else, the Admiral leaned forward again with another big smile.
Yes, Blackjack, you have returned.
He'd never liked the Blackjack nickname. But if Geary managed to show his reaction, the Admiral didn't notice it, speaking as if he was giving a speech.
Blackjack Geary, back from the dead, just as predicted in the legends, to help the Alliance win its greatest victory and finally put an end to this war with the Syndics.
Returned? Legends? The war was still going on after a century? Everyone he had known must be dead. Who were these people? And who did they think he was? John Geary bolted awake in his stateroom aboard Dauntless, gazing up at the overhead, breathing heavily and sweating even though his insides felt a lingering memory of the ice that had once filled him. It had been a while since he'd had flashbacks to the last moment of Merlin and his awakening aboard Dauntless a century later. He sat up, kneading his forehead with one hand while he tried to calm his breathing. Around him loomed the darkened outlines of his stateroom. The Admiral with the big voice had died in the Syndicate World's home star system after his plan to win the war had turned out to be an ambush by the Syndics. A lot of other people and Alliance warships had died with him. The survivors had turned to the legendary Blackjack Geary to save them, and despite Geary's abhorrence of the impossibly heroic figure that legends claimed Blackjack had been, he'd been forced to assume command of the fleet. After all, his commissioning date to captain had been almost a century earlier, and no other surviving officer in the fleet had anywhere near that much seniority. A number of them had doubted he could do it, doubted that he was truly the hero out of legend. But even though Geary privately shared those doubts, he'd known that he had to try. And so far, he'd done what seemed impossible. He'd brought the Alliance fleet back through Syndic space, a long, fighting retreat, using every skill he'd learned a century ago, skills lost to the fleet in the decades of bloodbath the war had become after Merlin's destruction. His eyes went to the star display floating over the table in his stateroom. He'd left it active when he went to sleep, centered on the star Dalawa. Still inside Syndic space, but only three more jumps away from reaching safety in Alliance space. He was so close to saving those who had believed he could save them. But the fleet was still inside enemy territory, still had to fight its way past the Syndic flotilla that would surely be waiting at the end of one of those jumps, and the loss of the Merlin had come back to haunt him. Geary exhaled wearily, then dug in a drawer for a ration bar. He eyed the bar dubiously. Like most of the food left in the fleet, the bar had come from Syndic stockpiles, abandoned in place when marginal star systems had been deserted after the introduction of the hypernet. It was food even the Syndics didn't think worth hauling away. While no doubt long past its expiration date, the bar and the other food they'd picked up had been frozen in airless vacuum since abandonment, and technically remained edible. The bar had a propaganda wrapper featuring impossibly heroic-looking Syndic ground troops marching from left to right. He tore the wrapper open, trying to avoid reading the ingredients, then started biting off and swallowing chunks of it. Despite his best efforts to avoid tasting the thing, he still ended up wincing at the flavor. Sailors in the Alliance fleet often complained about the food they got, but one of the few virtues of these Syndic supplies was that, aside from keeping you alive, they also made the Alliance rations taste wonderful by comparison. And, as the ancient joke went, not only was the food terrible, but there wasn't enough of it. The bar sat like a lead ball in Geary's stomach. But that wasn't why he didn't get another. A fleet cut off from resupply and trapped in enemy territory had to get by on short rations. He wouldn't eat better than his sailors. Though, considering the quality of the Syndic food, better probably wasn't the right term. His comm panel buzzed urgently, and Geary hit the acknowledge button.
Captain Geary, enemy ships have arrived at the jump point from Cavalos.
He slapped another control, and the star display winked out, to be replaced with a display showing just the Dalawa Star System and the ships within it. There hadn't been much in the way of Syndicate Worlds warships left in the Cavalo Star System when the Alliance fleet departed, unless you counted the wreckage of the Syndic warships that orbited Cavalos in slowly spreading clouds of debris. But there were plenty more Syndic warships hunting Geary's fleet, and the Alliance fleet was increasingly feeling the strain of the long retreat through Syndic space. Not all of the wreckage left at Cavalos had belonged to Syndic warships. The Alliance battlecruiser Opportune, the scout battleship Braveheart, and 9 Alliance cruisers and destroyers had also been lost in the battle there. Some torn apart in the battle, and some blown to pieces on Geary's orders because they had been too badly damaged to keep up with a retreating fleet. The pressure was wearing on him as well. His mind kept dwelling on the losses suffered thus far by the Alliance fleet, which was probably why he was getting post-traumatic stress flashbacks again. With an effort, he focused on what was happening now.
"Only 1 Huck and 2 nickel corvettes," Geary commented.
"That's right,"
Captain Dejani replied, her image popping up next to the display. She was on the bridge, of course, watching over her ship.
"Too bad they're almost 3 light hours away. Dauntless's Hell-Lance crews would enjoy the target practice."
"Not that your Hell-Lance crews need target practice, Tanya,"
Geary agreed, his remark earning him a proud grin from Dejani. As she'd noted, the jump point was 3 light hours distant from where the Alliance fleet was located deeper inside the star system, which meant the images he was seeing of the Syndic warships were 3 hours old.
"No one's following them in. They must be scouts."
"Agreed. We expect to see one of the nickels break to stay near the jump point. The other nickel and the hunter killer should accelerate toward the jump points for Calyxa and Heradao."
She paused.
"This is the first time I've seen a nickel corvette outside a Syndic-occupied star system. Those things are so obsolete, I'm surprised they risk them in jump space."
So obsolete, in fact, that nickel corvettes had been operating 100 years ago, back when they'd been given that nickname by the Alliance because they were seen as cheap and easily expended in battle. Back when the war began. Images from his flashback returned, of nickel corvettes making firing runs on Merlin.
"Sir?"
Dejani asked. Geary shook his head, startled to realize he'd let his mind drift like that.
"Sorry."
Only Geary might have been able to see the concern in the look Dejani gave him, but she went on speaking as if everything was routine.
"The first nickel corvette may jump back for Cavalos in a little while to let them know we're still here."
Her expression shifted, now professionally unrevealing.
"Since we are still here."
"We need everything we can salvage from the materiel the Syndics left behind when they pulled the last people out of this star system decades ago,"
Geary replied, trying not to speak angrily in response to Dejani's prodding.
"We've lifted all of the abandoned food already."
Dejani made a face.
"If I can use the term food loosely. The fleet is still going to have to reduce rations again to stretch out what food we've got left."
She shrugged.
"That's one good thing about the slop we're getting from the cast-off Syndic stockpiles. No one really wants to eat a lot of it, so shortening the rations doesn't bother the crews as much as it would if the food were edible."
"I guess there's a bright side to everything."
Geary smiled briefly as he rechecked the information on the raw minerals being loaded into the bunkers on the fleet's auxiliaries, then realized that Dejani had first made her point about the need for the fleet to move and then deliberately changed the subject to diffuse his resentment.
"I shouldn't be angry. It's a legitimate concern for every commanding officer in this fleet. When are we leaving Dalawa, and where are we going? We've been here for almost a day and a half, and that's probably at least 1 day too long."
There weren't any good reasons for staying at Dalawa. A star without any habitable worlds orbiting it, Dalawa had once boasted only a small human presence, perhaps several thousand, judging from the facilities the Syndics had left behind. Those humans had been here because the old faster-than-light system jump drives could only take ships from star to nearby star, requiring ships to pass through every star system on the way to their objectives. The hypernet had changed that, allowing ships to go from any gate in the net directly to any other gate, leaving the human presence in many unexceptional star systems to dwindle gradually as the interstellar traffic bypassed them. But those old jump drives were getting his fleet home, one star system at a time, and the hypernet had proved to be a threat to the very existence of humanity. Dauntless was also carrying a Syndic hypernet key, which could provide a decisive advantage to the Alliance if it could be safely delivered into Alliance space. If he didn't get the fleet home, that key and the knowledge of the threat posed by the hypernet would be lost, along with the warships and their crews. The costs of failure seemed higher every time he thought about them.
"Let me know if anything changes," he asked Dejani.
"Yes, sir."
Dejani's image disappeared, but not before her expression and her tone somehow conveyed the message that something needed to be changing and wasn't. He sat there, the star display centered on Delawa once again floating above the table before him. No matter how long he stared at it, though, the display refused to perform like a crystal ball and offer answers from its depths to the questions he had to resolve. Primarily, where to go from Delawa.
"Just make up your mind," Geary told himself.
He'd done it many times already during the fleet's long retreat through enemy space. It shouldn't have been that hard a decision. There weren't that many jumps left before the fleet reached a Syndicate Worlds border star system from which it could jump back to Alliance space. It should be easy, with safety so close. Instead, it felt harder every time he approached the decision. He kept hesitating, each possible choice running hard into visions of what had gone wrong at Lakota and the losses suffered at Kavalos. And now memories from the destruction of Merlin were adding to the mix. He'd considered asking Victoria Rione, co-president of the Kallus Republic and a member of the Alliance Senate, for her opinion. But the Alliance politician had refused to offer advice of that nature for some time. Outwardly, Rione claimed it was because she'd been wrong so many times in what she wanted the fleet to do. If there was another agenda driving Rione in the matter, he wasn't sure what it was. Though for a while they'd been off and on lovers in the physical sense, Rione had kept much of herself hidden from him, even during that phase of their relationship, before they both ended it. In any event, he'd seen little of her in the last couple of days.
"I need to concentrate on employing my informants throughout this fleet," she'd told him. "We need to find which Alliance officers have escalated their opposition to your command of the fleet, to the point of employing malicious worms in the fleet's operating systems."
Since those worms had once nearly caused the destruction of some of the fleet's ships, Geary couldn't argue with her priorities. There were others he could ask. Intelligent, reliable, and thoughtful officers like Captain Duellos of the Courageous, Captain Tulev of the Leviathan, and Captain Cressida of the Furious. But Geary sat alone and eyed his star display, feeling a strange reluctance to seek advice, despite knowing that further delay could be fatal. His hatch alert chimed, identifying the person seeking entry as Captain Dejani. He authorized entry, wondering what could have brought her here. Given the widespread rumors about his being involved with Dejani, she didn't come to his stateroom very often. The truth was that they were involved, though neither would, in any way, speak of or act on the feelings they hadn't sought. Not while he was fleet commander and she was in his chain of command.
"Has something happened?" he asked.
Dejani nodded toward the star display.
"I wanted to talk with you privately about your future operational plans, sir."
That should have been welcome, because he knew how well Dejani could handle a tactical situation. But this was an operational decision. Or so Geary told himself, wondering why he was reluctant to hear what she had to say. But how could he put her off? Admitting uncertainty would only justify Dejani's request to discuss the matter.
"All right."
She walked in, seeming unusually distant, then stood before the star display, not directly facing Geary.
"You seemed a little off earlier, sir."
"Bad dream."
Dejani looked his way with a wordless question, and Geary shrugged.
"About my old ship. And waking up and everything."
"Oh."
Dejani's eyes went back to the star display.
We were so caught up in finding you that we didn't realize how badly shaken you were. I've often wished we'd handled it differently, telling you how long it had been, the fate of your crew. I must have sounded very callous.
I don't think there was any good way to tell me all of that. No, you didn't strike me as callous. It was obvious you knew I had to be told, and no one else was going to do it.
Certainly not Admiral Block,
Dejani agreed.
I've often wondered what your first impressions of me were.
He grimaced, trying to remember. I wasn't thinking clearly at all. There was so much. I remember wondering how you could possibly have accumulated so many battle ribbons. And the Fleet Cross. How did you earn that, anyway? Dejani sighed.
At Fingal. I was just a lieutenant on the old buckler. We'd fought until the ship was a wreck and the Syndics boarded.
What did you do?
I helped fight them off.
Her gaze lifted, focused somewhere else. Any actions worthy of the Fleet Cross must have been a great deal more than helped fight them off, Geary commented.
I did my duty.
She fell silent for a moment. Geary respected Dejani's right to tell that story where and when she wanted. There might be a lot of trauma behind the events that had led to the medal. He watched her, surprised by the topics she'd brought up.
Did you come down here just to talk about those things?
Not just that.
She paused and took a deep breath.
I'm aware that you don't usually discuss your plans in advance,
Dejani began in much more formal tones.
Sometimes I do,
Geary admitted. She waited, but when he didn't say anything else, didn't offer his thoughts on what he intended, Dejani's brow lowered slightly. Her voice still didn't betray any emotion, however.
I've been reviewing the information we have on Syndic star systems we can reach from Dalawa. I assume you intend going to Heradao Star System, but you haven't yet communicated that intention, even though the fleet needs to leave this star system.
If he'd heard right, that was one of the closest things to a rebuke that he'd ever gotten from Dejani. Geary frowned a bit.
I haven't decided on our next destination.
There, he'd said it. Dejani waited again for him to elaborate, then spoke firmly.
The other star systems accessible from here are back to Kavalos, which wouldn't accomplish anything but getting us farther from home. Topira, which leads down and back into Syndic space. Jundine, which is isolated and would offer no destinations within jump range except back here. And Calyxa, which has a Syndic hypernet gate. Heradao is the only reasonable objective given the threat posed by that hypernet gate at Calyxa, and the lack of advantages in going to Kavalos, Topira, or Jundine.
I'm already aware of the situations in all of the star systems we can reach from here,
Geary replied.
Is there anything else?
She gave him a hard look, apparently ignoring his implied dismissal.
Some of the Syndic records we captured at San Seer indicate there are Alliance prisoners of war in a labor camp at Heradao.
I'm aware of that as well.
Captain Geary,
Dejani said in a low voice,
I am a fleet officer and the commanding officer of your flagship, and both of those positions require that I communicate my opinions and advice when I deem it necessary.
Geary nodded.
I don't deny that. You've given me your opinion.
Thank you.
There are a lot of other factors for me to consider.
Such as?
He stared at her, startled by the abrupt question.
I'm still formulating them in my own mind.
Perhaps I can help.
A wall of resistance rose in Geary, though he didn't understand why.
I appreciate the offer, but I'm not ready to discuss options yet. There are advantages and disadvantages to all possible star systems we can reach from here.
Captain Geary, it's not like you to avoid making a decision.
His frown returned, deeper this time.
I'm not avoiding making a decision. And this conversation isn't helping things. Is there anything else?
He repeated.
What about the Alliance prisoners of war at Heradao?
Dejani asked, her tone getting more clipped.
For one thing, Geary replied, getting aggravated himself, we don't know that they're still at Heradao.
The Syndic records we've acquired are all old. That POW camp might have been relocated a long time ago. For another thing, the Syndics will know that the presence of Alliance POWs in the system will increase the chance that this fleet will go there. And that means they could be laying a trap in Heradao right now. Dejani stood silently, her breathing unusually controlled, then finally spoke.
How would the Syndics know that we knew a POW camp was at Heradao? They don't know what Syndic records we've picked up.
That was a legitimate question, but for some reason it made Geary even more irritated. You know full well that I'm willing to take reasonable risks to rescue Alliance POWs.
Yes, sir.
No matter the literal meaning of the words, Geary had learned that a simple yes, sir from Dejani meant that she was unhappy, that she was disagreeing with something. I'm not at all certain that the advantages of going to Heradao outweigh the risks, Geary added, growing aggravation giving extra warmth to his words.
Sir, I must respectfully point out that there are risks no matter where we go, and the longer we linger here, the worse those risks will become.
Geary heard her tone and felt his jaw tighten. And I must respectfully point out that I, not you, have responsibility for the survival of this fleet.
I'll try to keep that in mind, sir,
Dejani stated crisply. Geary glowered at her. You know, that sort of attitude and this conversation aren't exactly making my life easier. She turned slightly to face Geary and glowered right back.
Not to be too blunt about it, but at the moment, the question of how easy your life happens to be is rather far down the list of priorities. That's true of a ship's commanding officer, and it's even more true of the fleet commander. I repeat that I have a duty to give the best advice I can to the commander of this fleet, and I will damned well do so even if he chooses to disregard it.
Fine. Geary made a sharp wave at the star display. What's your advice?
I told you. Go to Heradao.
And I told you that I've already considered that. She waited for him to continue, then shook her head.
You're afraid. I've seen it growing since Lakota and Kavalos.
Geary stared at Dejani, shocked to hear those words from her. Is that advice supposed to be helping me? Why are you talking like Numos or Fariza? Dejani's face reddened alarmingly.
Don't you dare compare me to those individuals, sir.
Geary tamped down his own temper and swallowed a biting response. She had a right to be upset. He never should have even implied Dejani was like those two officers. She wasn't political. She never questioned his status as commander of the fleet, and she was a fine commanding officer of her ship. All of which made her totally different from under arrest Captain Numos and now dead Captain Fariza. My apologies, Geary said in a stiffly proper voice. Why did you accuse me of being afraid?
I didn't accuse you.
Dejani made a visible effort to control her own anger.
I'm not trying to establish which of us was conceived with the bigger gonads, but in talking with you and observing you, I have seen subtle changes which have increased since Kavalos.
She nodded abruptly toward the star display.
Ever since assuming command of this fleet, you've used a mix of cautious and bold actions to keep the enemy off balance and win victories. I think you depend on your instincts for when to proceed boldly or cautiously, because neither I nor anyone else has been able to identify a pattern. But I can see a pattern now in you, and it tells me that you're afraid.
If anyone but Dejani were telling him this, if Rion were saying it, or one of his known opponents in the fleet. But it was Dejani. He'd had no firmer ally than her. No more reliable and capable supporter since assuming command of the fleet. She believed in him. Originally because Dejani was one of those who thought the living stars themselves had sent him back to save the fleet and the Alliance. But now also because of what she said she'd seen in him. If he didn't listen to Dejani, he'd be a fool. Geary took a couple of calming breaths. What pattern? She seemed to have calmed as well. Speaking determinedly, but without heat.
I've tried to see things through your eyes as the fleet commander. In the Syndic home star system and afterward, the odds of this fleet getting home seemed very small. Risks were easier to take because every possible course of action held serious threats. Caution often didn't make sense because boldness was necessary, and the obvious result of too much caution would have been the destruction of the fleet. But we're close to home now.
She pointed at the representation of Dalawa, then swung her hand to indicate Alliance space.
So close. And now risks seem more dangerous, because we've made it this far, against all odds. And you're looking at that and the small distance left to Alliance space and thinking how awful it would be to get the fleet this close and have it destroyed now, because you made a serious error.
I have made serious errors, Geary stated heavily. Such as taking this fleet to Lakota.
Which was a calculated risk, and in the end it worked. And taking us to Kavalos was a risk because we might encounter the Syndics there. And we did meet them. And we beat them.
Dejani clenched one fist and kept her eyes fixed on his.
The losses we took at Lakota and Kavalos were the worst since you assumed command. That wasn't your fault. Any other commander I know of would have lost a lot more ships in those battles, and would have lost the battles for that matter. Those losses weren't in vain. We've hurt the Syndics, badly, and we're close to home.
The words finally came out from deep inside him.
The ships we lost at Lakota and Kavalos won't reach home, and neither will most of their crews.
They died so their comrades would make it. Don't negate their sacrifices by becoming so fearful of more losses that you end up losing all. The time for risks is not past. I can understand how you fear failing now, after bringing the fleet this far. But we are still in enemy territory, and excess caution carries a great danger in itself. You can't win unless you try to win, but you can lose by trying not to lose.
She had a point. Had fear of failure after succeeding this far caused him to shy away from the sorts of risk he knew had to be taken to win, to survive? Geary gazed at the star display, trying to sort out his feelings and his thinking.
Do I follow my instincts or not? He finally said, as much to himself as to Dejani.
What are your instincts actually telling you? She asked.
The consequences of getting caught in a bad position again.
Those are your fears. What are your instincts saying?
Geary met her eyes again, realizing she was right.
Heradao.
Then follow them,
Dejani urged. He exhaled heavily, pointing to where the fleet's status was displayed.
Damn it, Tanya. You know the state of the fleet as well as I do. We've only got 20 battleships left, even if we count in Orion, and Orion appears determined to see how long it can possibly take to repair battle damage. There are only 16 battle cruisers remaining in the fleet. And of those, courageous, incredible, illustrious, and brilliant are barely combat capable after the damage they sustained at Kavalos. The scout battleship division is down to one surviving ship. There are exactly 41 Spectre missiles and 15 mines left in the entire fleet. And every cruiser and destroyer in the fleet has at least one weapons system jury-rigged to keep functioning despite battle damage. And fuel cell reserves on the fleet's warships are down to an average of only 52%. That's no way to go into a battle. Instead of answering immediately, Dejani reached over and highlighted the status of the four fleet auxiliaries.
I know you've already checked this. Goblin, Djinn, Witch, and Titan are working all out to manufacture what this fleet needs to keep going. But from the beginning, their efforts haven't been enough to gain ground on a logistics situation while we're facing constant threats inside Syndic territory. Even with all the risks we've taken to keep those auxiliaries supplied with the raw materials they need, they simply don't have the manufacturing capacity to keep up with this fleet's combat consumption of fuel cells and expendable weaponry, not with all of the maneuvering that your tactics demand.
He couldn't deny that. You're right. I've already checked that.
So you already know that until we get back to Alliance space, it's not going to get better.
Dejani hammered home.
The fuel cell situation is at the point where the auxiliaries have to devote everything they can to making new ones. Meaning, they can't manufacture new missiles. they can give us new grape shot, and stocks of that are rising to acceptable levels right now. But the missile and mine situation will not improve, and until we make it home, we're going to keep using fuel cells faster than we can make them. There won't be a better time to fight the Syndics than Heradao. We're low on everything, and we do have accumulated battle damage, but they've taken terrible losses. Given time, the enemy will recover faster than we can inside their own territory.
He looked at the star display again, his eyes going from Heradao across the light years to Alliance space. Dejani watched him for a few moments, then spoke again, her voice softer.
You're also worried about what happens when the fleet gets home, aren't you?
Geary shifted his gaze, his eyes locking on her again, as Dejani continued.
You're worried about facing a place you knew as home 100 years ago, and all the changes since then.
Dejani nodded toward the region of Alliance space.
Most importantly, you're much more worried about what most of this fleet expects you to do once we get home.
Did he have no secrets from this woman? Had he ever actually discussed those things with her in those terms? Geary shook his head, though not in denial of her words.
I won't do it, Tanya. I don't care if most of the fleet, and most of the citizens of the Alliance for that matter, want the great, legendary Blackjack Geary to ride in on a white horse and toss out the elected leaders of the Alliance. I won't destroy what makes the Alliance worth fighting for in the name of defending the Alliance. But a lot of people are expecting that. Some of those people will probably try to force my hand, and I have no idea how to deal with that.
Yes, you do.
Dejani's gaze held his.
You already know what you won't do. You have a strategic goal, to preserve what makes the Alliance worth fighting for and to end this war. Consider ways to implement that strategy, and the tactics will follow.
It's not that easy.
Not if you try to do it alone. Ask for advice. Is there no one you trust in this fleet except the politician?
That made Geary look away for a moment. Just as Rione had long since stopped using Dejani's name, Dejani herself had started referring to Co-President Rione only as the politician. On one level, the job description was true enough, but politicians were also despised by a fleet that, after a century of war, had come to blame them for the failure to achieve victory.
Do you want to know why I haven't asked you for advice on that? He asked.
It might be a refreshing change of pace for you to tell me.
Damn, what had gotten into Dejani?
Geary met her eyes once more.
Because I'm afraid you'll agree to whatever I say, that you'll break your own oath and follow me no matter what I do, because you believe that the living stars sent me to this fleet and are guiding me.
Dejani nodded, her expression resolute.
Yes, I would follow you.
As Geary openly winced, she held out a forestalling hand.
Because I know you were sent to this fleet with a divine mission, and that you do benefit from special guidance. Because of that, I also know that you will not do something that you have sworn not to do. I know you will not destroy the Alliance, and therefore I know I can follow you and help you, if you will let me. There are others who will help you figure out a course of action if you confide in us, and I'm sure you know who they are. Give us credit for loving the Alliance as much as you. I admit that at one time I could have been talked into accepting a military coup, but not now. Not after the things of which you've reminded us all. Our own attempts to match Syndic brutality have only served to convince the Syndic populace of the need to keep fighting hard against us, and there wouldn't be much point in winning if victory meant becoming the mirror image of our enemies. But like the problems with the Syndics, political problems within this fleet and at home will not get better if you defer dealing with them.
A host of retorts and rebuttals came to Geary, but he knew every single one of them would either deny what he knew to be the truth or avoid the real issues. He sat staring at the stars once more, as the fragments of what he knew and what Dejani had said fell into place inside his own mind, forming a picture he recognized as accurate. Then he finally nodded.
Thank you. You're right. About everything. I've been avoiding a decision. I was seeing it all, but I wouldn't put it together because I was haunted by the thought of losing this fleet on the threshold of safety, and because I was letting worries about what would happen when we got home further paralyze me. Dejani grinned, the tension having suddenly fled from her.
We're going to Heradao?
Yes, Tanya. We're going to Heradao. We're going to get those Alliance prisoners of war, if they're still there. And we're going to defeat whatever force the Syndics might have gathered at Heradao. And I'm going to work on that strategy for when we reach Alliance space.
You can ask Captain Duelos, Captain Tulev.
And you, Geary interrupted her list. It seems you're a very important part of my special guidance.
Dejani actually flushed slightly at the praise.
I wouldn't have reached these decisions on my own, and I've been avoiding anyone who would make me confront that. I needed you to push me into it because you know me a lot better than I realized you did, and because you're a tough enough bitch to make me see what I was doing.
She smiled wider.
This tough bitch has had to deal with a lot of difficult sons of bitches in her time. You're one of the more reasonable ones, sir.
Thank you.
He hesitated.
Tanya, none of the other senior officers in the fleet seems to have picked up on what was bothering me.
You've never openly spoke of your growing caution. Knowing you well, from all the talks we've had, from all of the experiences we've described to each other, did make a difference. But from watching you, I also knew that you were smart enough to realize how important advice from others can be. The fact that you were recently working to avoid such advice told me something, too.
I guess I need to thank my ancestors that you're the captain of my flagship. Thank them again, I mean.
One corner of Dejani's mouth curled up in a half smile.
I'll take that as a professional compliment. Now, by your leave, sir, I have other matters to attend to, and you need to formulate the orders for the fleet's movement to Heradao.
Certainly, Captain Dejani.
He wrenched his eyes away from her smile and his mind away from wondering how her lips would feel against his. That wouldn't happen. Not while he was in command of the fleet. Not while this war lasted. She'd earned his respect countless times, and even if he'd failed to maintain proper professional feelings toward her, he could still be sure to grant her that respect in both public and private. So Geary simply stood up and returned her salute. But she paused just before leaving and looked back at him.
I hope you don't take adversely anything I said, sir. I did feel obligated to speak honestly and forcefully.
Thank you, Captain Dejani. I hope you will continue to speak with as much honesty and force whenever you feel it is appropriate, and I will listen when you do so. I've been told that I am one of the more reasonable sons of bitches in the fleet.
That's probably true, sir, but don't let it go to your head.
He managed not to laugh until the hatch had closed behind her.
Chapter 2. The fleet conference room on Dauntless wasn't all that large, and the table and seats it boasted could have held no more than a dozen people at the most. But the virtual conferencing software made the apparent size of the table and the compartment expand to accommodate the numbers of people in any meeting, so that Geary stood at the head of an extremely long table with hundreds of officers seated around it. Aside from him, Captain Dejani, and Co-President Rione, none of the other individuals were actually physically present. As much as he disliked fleet conferences, Geary had to admit the software was an impressive piece of work, and the fact that most of those present weren't actually here had kept anyone from going for anyone else's throat during arguments in the past. Unfortunately, there didn't seem much chance of open argument this time. As much as he had disliked bandying words with the likes of Numos or Cassia or Medea, at least the straightforward hostility of their attitudes had made it clear who needed to be watched. He would have welcomed that now, as a chance to identify the remaining opposition to his command of the fleet. But whoever was driving that effort seemed to have expended most of their human shields, yet was remaining frustratingly hidden. If the only threat they posed was to his command, he wouldn't have expended much worry on them, since after the Second Battle of Lakota, his standing with the sailors and most of the officers of the fleet was as firm as hull armor. but his hidden foes had repeatedly demonstrated a willingness to endanger some of the fleet's warships in their attempts to strike at Geary. The game had shifted from trying to topple him to trying to assassinate him and his firmest supporters, which, in practice, meant trying to destroy the ships they were on. Geary called up the star display over the conference table.
My apologies for the delay in communicating my intentions. We've stripped Dalawa of everything of use to us. I've already ordered the fleet onto a course for the jump point for Heradao.
On the display, the projected path of the Alliance fleet curved in a graceful arc through the empty reaches of Dalawa's star system.
We hope to find that the Alliance prisoners of war are still at Heradao, in which case we'll liberate them. We need to liberate more food along with them, Captain Tulev stated bluntly. What we have is inadequate.
Commander Neeson of Implacable shook his head.
We can't loot enough unless we occupy a planetary surface warehouse district, and that's beyond our Marines' capability. We also can't trust any food the Syndics give us under duress, and we can't test it all thoroughly.
2,000 prisoners at Heradao, according to the old records we have,
Tulev pointed out.
We must liberate them, I agree. Physically, we can hold them. Some of our ships are still slightly under strength from battle casualties, even with the survivors we've picked up from ships we've lost. And the others can take on extra personnel for the time needed to reach Alliance space. But the food situation is growing critical.
You mean like the fuel situation?
Captain Armis of the Colossus grumbled. Geary held up a hand to quiet everyone.
We're short on everything. However, the logistics systems project that even if we pick up 2,000 liberated Alliance personnel, we'll be able to make Alliance space without running out of food, though rations will have to be reduced again.
And if we are delayed? Tulev asked.
We can't afford any more delays,
Geary replied.
Fuel and food are at critical levels, and the only source we can count on for resupply is back in Alliance home space. We're going to keep moving and fighting. We've had to be very concerned with keeping the Syndics guessing as to our route home, but from this point on, we're heading straight there.
Relieved smiles appeared on many faces as Geary shifted the scale on the star display, but then the smiles faded on most faces. Armis put the worry into words.
A direct route increases the chances of running into Syndic blocking forces. How can we fight through those forces if we're low on fuel?
Pray to our ancestors for a miracle, occurred to Geary as an answer, but hoping for divine intervention wasn't a sound basis for tactical planning.
By fighting as smart as we can to minimize fuel cell usage. If necessary, we'll try to blow past the blocking forces and leave them in our wake.
That intelligent and reasonable idea drew grimaces around the table. It was too contrary to the primitive concepts of honor and courage that had controlled the fleet's actions for at least a generation, and led to horrendous losses as well. But Geary had gained enough experience with those attitudes to know how to satisfy them.
We can always come back and destroy those Syndic ships once we've refueled, or leave them for the Alliance warships that have been defending our home space in our absence, and deserve an opportunity to get in their own blows.
The grimaces lightened, and some smiles reappeared as Geary continued.
There's a strong possibility that whatever the Syndics have left to try to stop us will be waiting at Heradao, because it's a straight shot back home for us. If a Syndic flotilla is at Heradao, we will fight them there, because our fuel stocks will be as good as they're going to be until we get home.
He glanced at Captain Dejani, who betrayed no sign that Geary was practically quoting her own advice.
I can't afford to feed rumors of favoritism toward Dejani now, but once this is over, I'll make sure that she and people like her get the credit they deserve.
Outwardly, Geary just indicated a bright white star.
After Heradao, we'll go on to Padronus, and from there to Italia.
A sigh seemed to run around the table as Captain Badea of Illustrious spoke the thoughts probably on everyone's mind.
And Atelia is within jump range of Verandal.
Right,
Geary agreed.
Alliance home space, and the biggest concentration of fleet support facilities in the region. Once we reach Verandal, we can get all of the supplies we need.
Boldness is certainly called for.
Captain Caligo of the battlecruiser Brilliant agreed. The Alliance needs us, and every Alliance prisoner of war we can liberate from within Syndic territory. That unobjectionable statement drew nods of agreement as Geary took a moment to look at Caligo. He'd been mostly silent at these meetings until recently, but had begun speaking up. Not that Caligo had yet said anything exceptional, just things that found concurrence with almost everyone.
Our intelligence personnel believe the Syndic mine inventories must still be very low after all of the mines they laid in the star systems around the Coda to try trapping us,
Geary continued.
We'll still do a pre-programmed evasive maneuver upon arrival at Heradao and be ready for combat coming out of the jump exit. Are there any questions?
What about Calyxa?
Captain Keela asked. It's on the way home, too, and it has a Syndic hypernet gate. Her tone seemed to be intended to be mild, but was still sharp. Diplomacy definitely wasn't Keela's strong suit, but then he already knew that.
We're not going to Calyxa,
Geary replied.
The risks posed by a Syndic hypernet gate are too great.
Keela pretended puzzlement.
Are risks a problem for this fleet? We're not afraid of what the Syndics can do, Captain Geary, but this would be a good opportunity to inflict more damage on them by eliminating another star system of theirs.
Commander Neeson sounded incredulous.
Excuse me, Captain Keela, but you were at Lakota with us, weren't you? Our own fleet could have been destroyed.
It wasn't,
Keela pointed out.
Avoiding actions out of exaggerated fears of the enemy response isn't what's expected of any commander in this fleet, let alone a battlecruiser commander.
Neeson's face flushed with sudden anger.
Are you accusing me of cowardice?
Quiet,
Geary ordered.
Everyone. Captain Keela, your statement was out of line.
She shrugged.
I didn't mean offense, merely to point out...
That's enough.
He could see the flare of defiance in Keela's eyes as he cut her off.
Commander Neeson has demonstrated his courage many times. I will not tolerate attempts to question the abilities or the bravery of anyone in this fleet without good cause.
Captain Cressida, who had clearly been waiting for an opening, jumped in.
Commander Neeson is also right. The energy discharge when the hypernet gate at Lakota collapsed was on the low end of the theoretical range. I'll remind Captain Keela that the high end runs up to a Nova-scale burst of energy. No ship in the same star system could possibly survive that, even if located as far as possible from the gate when it collapsed. In theory,
Keela replied sarcastically.
We didn't see anything like that at either Sunseer or Lakota, so perhaps the theory is wrong, and the gates may be safely used by us as weapons to eliminate Syndic star systems, and finally make them pay in full for what they've done in this war. That statement,
Cressida returned with growing heat,
reflects a total misunderstanding of what is known about the hypernet gates and the data we collected at both Sunseer and Lakota.
That's enough,
Geary broke in again.
Captain Cressida is right. We don't need to debate the science here. Captain Keela, I recommend you familiarize yourself with what is known before you make suggestions for courses of action.
Keela reddened at the barely veiled rebuke. Daring's captain nodded.
As for being able to ride out, taking down a hypernet gate, we all saw what happened to the Syndic warships that took down their own gate at Lakota.
Our ships?
Keela began.
At Sunseer, my ship was right up there while it was collapsing, and Inspire was a long ways distant. I know exactly what it's like to be near a collapsing hypernet gate, and I don't want any part of that again, no matter what you say. Only luck and the living star saved us at Sunseer and Lakota.
Luck, courage, and brains,
Geary added.
As long as this fleet continues to use the last two, we can save the first for emergencies. And as for using the hypernet gates to destroy enemy star systems, I've already stated that I will not order such an action. Neither the living stars nor our ancestors could possibly approve of such an atrocity and on such a scale.
It appears, Captain Duelos observed, that there's no reason to go to Calyxa then.
Keela shot him an ugly look as Captain Caligo chimed in once more.
We're one fleet.
We all believe in the same things. Arguments like this only serve the goals of the enemy by driving us apart. That brought many more nods of approval. Geary couldn't find fault with Caligo's words either, and for some reason they even shut up Keela, who finally subsided.
Are there any other questions?
Geary asked dryly. There weren't, and the meeting ended in a flurry of images vanishing and the room apparently shrinking back to normal dimensions again. Captain Duelos lingered for a moment.
I have to confess, I was starting to wonder why we hadn't headed out of Dilawa before now.
I needed to have my head pounded with a brick,
Geary admitted.
Ah, I see.
How fortunate that you had Captain Dejani handy for that task. Dejani gave Duelos an annoyed look.
Don't you have better things to be doing right now, Roberto?
Duelos nodded, then smiled.
Call me if you ever need another brick, Tanya.
I'll do that. He's got a hard head. I bet you've saved up quite a supply of bricks, so they'll be handy for arguments with Keela.
She's not worth our time, Duello said dismissively. I only speak with her when duty requires it.
Geary grimaced in response.
I'm just glad she shut up before I had to outright order her to do that.
Even Keela couldn't object to what Caligo said.
Yes, she could have,
Dejani insisted.
Even the blandest statement can be twisted. I was surprised she accepted it so quietly.
Duelos pursed his lips in thought.
That's a point. But you're implying that Keela and Caligo have some sort of agreement. They don't socialize. I don't know of anyone who's ever seen them together except in meetings like this one, and they're not exactly soulmates.
I won't argue that, Dejani conceded.
How well do you know Captain Keela?
Geary asked. Dejani shrugged.
I've had little contact with her, but that's been by choice based on what I've heard from friends. And I've heard plenty.
What did your friends say?
Another shrug.
They say that Keela's bitch switch is locked into the on position and comes with a power boost setting that activates at the slightest provocation.
Geary managed to convert his laugh into a cough.
That sounds like good.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.